Everybody, I'd like to welcome you to Lockport Township's monthly meeting for the month of March here. I'd like to start out tonight with the Pledge of Allegiance.
Attorney Gary Mueller.
Present.
Trustee Dean Relly.
Here.
And Trustee Barb Holtz.
Here.
All right, thank you. First of all, I'd like to welcome everybody to our new building. This is our first meeting here at this building, and this is where we'll be having our meetings monthly now. We are still in growing pains. We're going to be sharing mics, and hopefully everybody can hear us all right, but I'd like to welcome you to our building. That being said, everybody should have in their packet the minutes of the regular monthly meeting for the Road and Bridge of February 6th and the reconvened meeting of February 27th of 2017. I do need a motion to pass the minutes.
I'll make a motion.
I got a motion by Barb Boyce.
I'll second that, Ron.
I got a second by Dean Morella. Any questions in the minutes for the Road and Bridge? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, bills pass, or minutes pass. You have the bills of $34,413.30. I do need a motion to pay the bills.
I'll make that motion.
I'll second that.
I got a motion by John Bonner, second by Michael Lewandowski. Any questions for the bills? Hearing none, can I have a roll call, please?
Bodicich?
Yes.
Lewandowski?
Yes.
Alvarico?
Yes.
Boyce?
Yes.
Morelli?
Yes.
All right, any citizens here wishing to address the board for the Highway Department here tonight? All right, please come up to the podium here. And I'm going to ask, because we are a little short on mics.
I can project.
I think it sounds like the acoustics are way good.
I'm going to let you guys, this mic will pick up pretty good. It's pretty hot, so.
Thanks.
I believe you have to state your name for the record.
My name is Lynn Starks Howard, and I am a former resident of Lockport. However, my mom and sister live in Lockport right now. I think I talked to Mr. Alvarico, and I think we're almost peers, quarters. Lynn Starks, I think I talked to you on the phone. I'm here because of a concern that I have. When I come to visit my mother, I go up Harvard Hill. And one day, I went up the hill, and I looked on both sides, and I was shocked and hurt. I think those are the two words I'll use right now. At the amount of garbage and trash that are on the sides of the road. This was a day when there was no snow on the road. I know that somebody has to take care of the roads when there's snow, because I do go up the hill when there's snow and it has been plowed. So I started thinking about my mother, who is in her 80s now. All nine of us grew up on the Hill. We graduated, most of us graduated from Lockport Central.
Joliet West Tiger.
And honestly, I have never seen that amount of trash in my mother's neighborhood ever. Knowing that she's up in age, knowing that she has several young grandchildren who can come and visit her, knowing that that type of trash attracts rodents, I not only feared for my mother's safety, but the safety of my nieces and nephews, great nieces, great nephews. So I'm here to, I guess I'll use the word plead with you, because something definitely needs to be done. And I really pray that it's not, something is not done after something tragic happens, you know, lock the gate after the horse gets out. I'm going to relinquish the mic to my sister. However, I would like to say that the people I know who live in that area are not dumping trash in that area. These are not my mother's neighbors who are dumping trash in that area.
My sister talked about the roads being cleared, the streets being cleared. I lived on Craig for about 4 years. And one of the first things I noticed after I moved there was the difference between Lockport and Joliet. As far as street cleaning goes, I told my mom, Lockport needs to give Joliet lessons because it's just so good and it's so timely. Like you wake up at 2:30 or whenever you need a snowplow. Like mom said this morning, did you get a snowplow? Because I don't think you needed it, but if you had, it would have been out there because she rides your bike on it with that snow. I'm sorry to come with like a complaint, but it's out of hand. I have some pictures I'd like to share with the board, and it is an ongoing problem. These pictures were taken on March 6th, last week, but this is an ongoing problem, as you know. Now, our frustration is we called the township. We talked with Mr. Albrito's office, Mr. Selinsky's office. We referred to Will County Land Use. They referred us back to you. We had a couple people come and actually look to see what was there. It's like, who does that? And like Lynn said, no, it's not people that we know. This is an ongoing problem, and it's been ongoing for some time. So we're frustrated because we're calling, it's disgusting, it's an insult, and we're just being like, oh, it's not us, it's them. Oh, it's not us, it's them. So we're frustrated. So that's why we wanted to come to the board meeting and actually ask for help. We don't know what to do. Now, maybe cameras would discourage it, I don't know. But something definitely needs to be done. I'd like to share the pictures, which I think is too easy.
The board of trustees, you can start with Mr. Morelli, there.
No, I have to say, everybody we talked to on the phone was like really nice and cordial and helpful. But the bottom line was we didn't get any help. So this is not a reflection. You need to know how kind you were on the phone and how concerned. But the bottom line is the problem is not fixed. So I guess we need to leave it in your hands.
Unless somebody has questions.
You know, I work in that area.
Okay. I'm
familiar with those roads. And I too saw Harvard Hill back in the fall. And it was not a pretty sight by any means.
No.
I too took pictures
okay.
of those, that area. Mm-hmm. I'm just curious if some of that stuff is probably the same garbage I saw there in the fall.
I think the computer monitors are missing. I think those are.
There was a TV set?
Yeah, that's gone.
Actually, there was also a section of it that someone had dropped off. That's gone.
Right. And I do know there has been some communication regarding garbage pickup for people in the Fairmont area who they don't have garbage pickup.
Mm-hmm.
Which that's something I think the board in the near future has to look at and address. And I'm sure that would help not only Harvard Hill area or Harvard Avenue, but other parts of the south side of our township.
Mm-hmm.
Those tires, I mean, it is the, you know, it should happen nowadays, you know, in the year 2017, you know. So, but they will definitely be, it will definitely be addressed. You know, obviously you're going to give us some time here. But if it's coming from outside the area, you know, that's, I don't know. If John will kind of please me get involved a little bit, you know.
Well, yeah, I want to make a couple of comments as well. 99% of it is not coming from the neighbors that live there. We know
exactly.
That.
Well, we see them in the trash.
Yeah, absolutely.
So we know something.
Last year, I think there was around 12, 14 cleanups.
Around 14 cleanups.
Basically, what's going on is people are dumping in areas where the lots are wooded. And Harvard Hill is a very difficult location because you have trees on both sides.
Right.
So I don't want to jump around too much here because I don't want to confuse anybody. So we had last year, they had about 12, I think, cleanups. We donated the garbage bags. Ron donated the vest. We donated some gloves. And we had community cleanups. And Harvard Hill was the last one, I believe, on the list. And so this was back in August, I think.
August.
So from August to what you see today is how bad it got. We have been meeting with the Fairmont Community Group on the third Monday of every month. And they are talking about investing in some cameras on Harvard Hill. My suggestion was to, on the vacant lots that are wooded, I think if we clear those, you're gonna see less dumping. We had a big cleanup on Exhibition. Where we cleaned out as much as we can. We technically are not supposed to go on private property as far as like cleaning stuff, you know, like knocking down trees. But there are some lots out there, I don't know if you noticed on the corner of Princeton and Green Garden, where we cleared that whole corner because no one could see the stop sign. You couldn't see around the corner. It's a very dangerous intersection. We contacted we looked up the homeowner. I couldn't get a hold of them, so we actually ended up clearing that, which was a good thing. But getting back to the garbage. So what basically happens is we had a whole community go out there and they would put all their bags, Mother's Earth, was it the Helper? Remember the name of that group? Virgil's group?
Virgil's group.
He had a church group from Minnesota, I believe, come down, or Michigan, they were out of state. They came in and they filled up these orange garbage bags, they leave them on the side of the road, they give me a call and we throw them in our dumpster. So Virgil and that group did a great job. So we have been working on it. Now we did have a little understanding with the highway department and the Elks Club. I would give them the garbage bag and they would go up and down and clean it. And in exchange, I gave them grindings for their parking lot and we kind of redid their parking lot. It's kind of community helping communities. Like, hey, that's great. Because I've got five full-time guys. So it's difficult in the wintertime to get some of that picked up. However, we were the ones who picked up the sectional. We picked up the tires. Oh, yeah, no, we were there. We picked up the tires. We picked up several TVs. There was actually bags of cinder blocks just thrown over to the side. The actual little trash we have not got to. There's a couple of different avenues that we're looking at. You know, years ago they had the community service workers. So I was told that I could probably contact some of the court system itself. And I didn't realize this until recently that if you get in trouble with the law, or kids get in trouble and they have community service hours, the judge can actually send them to an area. So I think that that would be a prime area up and down Harvard Hill, especially. So, I mean, there are some people really looking at this hard, land use is looking at it hard. We will cooperate with, and we have been cooperating. It just seems, like you said, we had all the trash picked up on Harvard Hill in August, and this is, it was terrible last month. And that's, when I sent my guys over there with the trucks to get the couch and the sectional TVs, they were amazed that...
Yeah, they weren't allowed to pick up, I know you use the word little garbage, meaning just like household garbage. Not that it's a little.
No, I'm talking about hand-picked.
Yeah.
Because I've only got five guys that take all, it would take all five guys probably 2 days, maybe. I mean, would that be a fair estimate? So what I can do is to put aside some money in the budget for extra part-timers.
Okay.
I would rather go the community service route because then no money changes hands. You have people that need the community service hours and you have a good project that they're working on. They're just not walking up and down saying, hey, when are my 8 hours up? I'm out of here. So the community is looking into the whole neighborhood as a whole. I don't know if they're going to be doing any more of the community cleanups. I thought they were extremely successful. I've got the biggest dumpster that you can get from waste management, and they did a nice job, yeah, filling those up. So, I mean, there's people that are concerned, there's people that are involved. It just seems to be a little bigger of a problem. I don't want to say bigger, it's a revolving problem that just gets...
It needs to be managed.
Yes, it's kind of like you...
The concern is we are looking for Minnesota to come and help us. It's like it should be managed. That should be part of the township. So we don't want to have to depend on another state, a community group, or whatever. We need your help. We need you to get that area cleaned up, and we need to keep it clean. I don't think there's anybody sitting here who thinks that's okay.
Absolutely not.
I didn't think so.
No,
because
by
the way I talked to you, I know you don't think it's okay.
No.
But it's not okay. It needs to be fixed. It needs to be managed. There needs to be a plan in place to keep it on an ongoing basis and picked up.
Right?
Now, I was talking to, I'm not sure, maybe Denise, but who does that? Who comes and dumps garbage? It's like common sense would tell you don't do that, but then I told her common sense is not that common anymore. So people, you know, oh, I'm going to pay trash bill. Well, we're victims. I think I'm a victim.
Yeah.
Have you come to any of the Fairmont community meetings on the third Monday? Is it Delinda?
Yeah.
Delinda kind of, they're really working hard with land use, and of course, like I said, I'm you know, all about that, trying to get.
Who's the person? I'm sorry.
Is it,
what's your name?
Delinda.
Delinda.
I don't know her last name right off
here. I'm asking because we were attending those meetings, and I received an email saying that it was being dissolved.
Dissolved. Ron and I were just there last month, so I'm probably not going to be there this month.
This is news to me.
They had, actually, I was quite surprised because last month they had probably 15 or 20 people. It seems to me, and please, I don't go to every month's meetings, but it seems like they're getting stronger and getting more involved. There's a gentleman, his first name is Terry. He's been involved a lot in the cleanups. And also, the picture there with the tires goes down a ravine, and I can, you know, personally tell you that we did hit that one time. I think, Ron, you got poison ivy?
Yes,
we pulled a lot of tires out of there, but the problem is those places need to be cleaned up, and we have to, yes, we have to figure out how to do that. And then they did discuss, like you mentioned, they discussed cameras on Harvard Hill. They were worried about a cost-effective way to put them up there, where they're not going to get rocks thrown at them or shot out or whatever the case may be. But I can assure you that we're definitely, first of all, we know about the problem. We do know about it. And there's several agencies working on it. It's an ongoing problem. It'd be one thing if we could go in there and clean it up and then we don't have to do it for 2 years.
Yeah,
No, I think what's happening is they're just driving by and throwing up. When the bigger stuff, they use that as a dump. You know, that sectional was a big sectional.
It was
heavy. Yes, yeah. So, but we definitely I'm at the highway department. I can meet with you, you know, privately if you'd like. And I can go over some of the more detail of what's going on.
Well, yes, okay. So John, whose jurisdiction is that? Is it the highway department, townships, or is this a question?
Well, our easement rights are 33 feet off the center of the road. So now we come into a question of whether or not it's the highway department's responsibility to pick up the garbage in that 33 feet, or are we, the easement rights, just there for us to do work on the road? I don't have that answer. I don't know. This has been an ongoing problem for how many years?
Well, who does have the answer? Who would know?
Because I had to run around to, and I say that meaning we'll call here, call there. Not that anybody was rude. No one was rude to me.
Actually, I believe the biggest problem is the jurisdiction falls on the landowner.
Well, see, that's just it.
And the lands nobody's running the land. Nobody takes care of their, you know, what's the word I'm looking for? Abandoned land. So no, nobody owns the land. John doesn't have the right to go on it. Land use doesn't have the real legal right to go on it. So we go on it anyway and clean it up. Mm-hmm. And then people from outside the community know that it's dark and it's a dumping area, and they don't.
It's very dark.
I understand your frustration. I really
And you know it's on anyone's personal property, or I ask them if it was on someone's property, I would ask them, please clean up.
Well,
we
actually
work together.
Harvard Hill is a little bit different. Yeah, that's a different area than the rest of the Fairmont community.
You know, as far as I'm concerned, if it's in our right of way, we have to pick that up.
Yeah.
You know, we're in charge of the roads, the right of ways of those roads. Mm-hmm. Harvard Avenue is, it's only, maybe 2 feet of maybe our right of way. Then you're hitting the trees.
Right.
It is unique. But, you know, that area along the roads, whether it's Bruce Road, Harvard, Oak, Noak, whatever, you know, that's our responsibility as far as I'm concerned. Mm-hmm. You know, if it gets into private property, and some of those properties are very, very bad shape, mm-hmm. and that's where we would get in contact with the land use mm-hmm. and go through that battle, which takes, unfortunately, time.
Yeah. But it has happened. There's a house that's abandoned on Princeton. It wasn't abandoned at the time. Mm-hmm. People were actually living there and just putting garbage, and landers did come to the rescue and got not only all the trash out, but they eventually moved. I don't know if they had anything to do with that, but so we do know that on a personal property, there's recourse, but this is a street.
Yeah. Right. And streets on us, property is us working with land use. Mm-hmm.
I guess my question is, if someone did get hurt, who would be liable?
Somebody got hurt on private property?
No. Let's say a huge rat ran into my mom's yard and bit one of my nieces. Who would be responsible? That would be a good place to call a lawyer.
We said no one.
No.
Nobody would be responsible.
No, it's a rat.
Just
if somebody even probably tripped over that garbage right along that
driveway,
it's still because there's laws that protect government agencies in that regard.
Mm-hmm.
So
okay.
It still would be really a recourse there. Okay. It may be attempted, but.
Mm-hmm. As far as the garbage pickup, I've investigated that, and Gary's talked to me about that and checked into. In order to force people to have garbage pickup on their water bills,
mm-hmm.
We would have to go to a referendum.
Mm-hmm.
And the referendum would have to be township wide.
But you know, I don't think we need, it's not people who live there doing
it. I don't think so either. That's
so we don't want to like focus on that.
That's the right answer.
That's not the problem.
Land use has talked to me about trying to get garbage pickup, and the reason it's so expensive for garbage pickup to do it that way, the garbage companies have to have a guarantee of getting paid.
Sure.
So they, you know, they're afraid to, if we don't put it in the water well,
they won't get paid.
They won't get paid.
Okay. Just a real quick question. On these, they look like a couple isolated areas. Are there any other areas concerned throughout the area? outside of these?
Harbor Hill is, I think, the main dumping ground. But I would say that along Princeton sometimes, if you turn off of Cliff onto Princeton, by the house that's now abandoned, every now and then you'll see trash. But I agree with Elaine, Harvard Hill is the worst, and I'm not quite sure why the other spots are getting attention. It's because they must be getting attention.
I don't think they're getting as much attention as you think, based on my experience. I think what the problem is, Harvard Hill is almost like a tunnel, and people know they can get away with that there. There's nobody there. I'd be more than happy to, again, sit down with you guys and come up with some solution. Maybe add more stoplights, or not street lights through there. Maybe light it up a lot more. I mean, people tend to like to throw things away that they shouldn't in the dark. So maybe we can add some street lights over there, and maybe we can actually all meet with Melinda and see where they're at with maybe community cleanups for next, you know, next.
Okay, who actually has that area under surveillance? Who actually, like, monitors that area?
Well, county police.
Because there is a sign posted, no dumping allowed.
I would tell you this is, there is an issue in the city of Lockport. Mm-hmm. They have a dumping problem. And the cameras don't have to be expensive. They've got cameras, you may see Lockport when you say this, but they got cameras set up where just portable cameras that were able to catch people illegally dumping. Mm-hmm. So that's something that could be looked at for a very reasonable cost.
Okay, that's
good.
Okay, well, I'm going to forward these pictures to everyone who has an email address online. Kind of remind you, because I've got these back now. It's just, you know, it's, I don't know, it's very distressing. So I'll forward, you know, the pictures to you. And we will be in contact with you to find out when we can sit and talk about it. Mm-hmm. It's a major problem. It's very disheartening. It's very discouraging. You know, we don't want, like, when somebody comes to visit us, oh, no, don't turn on Harvard Hill. Go up to, it's like, no, it's not good. It's not good. So thank you.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We appreciate you coming and your concern. All right, next on the agenda is the Highway Commissioner's report.
Thank you very much. Not a lot. The rain, that's probably the biggest thing. We got 3.5 inches of rain in about an hour last week or a week before. And I think I mentioned the last meeting, and you guys thought it was kind of funny when I said I'd rather have snow than rain. Everybody kind of laughed. But the rain, you can't do anything about. Bruce Road and Fairmont Community both were underwater. Actually, most of the whole Lockport area was underwater. So that's that was a tough tough couple of days with the rain. Other than that, snow, we went out a couple of times today. We're expecting some more overnight. We'll probably go out again in the morning to keep the roads clean. The guys did a great job. I really got a good crew. I'm really happy about that. And then I know that there was a lot of questions last month about the FEMA grant denial. And so I asked Mr. Steve Dahl, who was with Morris Engineering, to come to the meeting today, so that if there's any questions that you guys have that maybe I didn't answer properly, he can address those questions for you. If anybody has any questions, I can have Mr. Dahl come up. You have a question?
We'll see what he has to say first.
Yeah, I just put him on the agenda so that if you guys have questions, he's on the agenda, and we don't have a time limit, like, you know, you know, like,
I guess,
time limit.
Yeah, I got more than enough questions, but this thing's been going on ever since I've been on the board. I've noticed right from the beginning that.
Hang on one second. Can we have him come up here? Maybe he's got to come on the record. But
sure. Why don't you come up, Mr. Dahl? I think I've heard you on the radio.
I work for a living.
It's definitely Steve Dahl.
I think you've got that selling here to go get him.
I'm Lance McCollum, the collector. I think I was appointed a little bit over a year ago. I noticed the FEMA right away, and I noticed a large amount of money on. So I'd asked John questions along the line. Oh, thank you. throughout that whole year's process. We finally received last month a denial. Okay. So I guess my question, seeing how I got you here, was what was the process that took so long for the denial?
Okay, I'll stick with general terms of the price of the dates, but I can leave this here for you.
You can have me with sophisticated terms.
Yeah, okay. It was the award for the FEMA grants was done based on the storms in April and May of 2013. And from that, they allocated some money for high road culvert replacement.
Can't leave yet.
And it was kind of earmarked for, you know, fill out the necessary paperwork. So you go through a series of documentation. What was interesting is you go through each process, they would ask for more information, they ask for more information. So you constantly give them whatever they're asking for to be in compliance with the grant. About spring of 2015, John was getting some notices that the grants were going to expire if work wasn't completed by, I think, August 1st of 2015. There were a series of appeals that you could go through in order to get that extension. There were also some limitations, and we were consulting with other engineers.
So did we appeal?
We appealed for the extension that was granted.
And how many appeals did we appeal?
The appeal was specific for the work activity at that time. And we were granted the appeal to complete the work. The work was completed in August of 2015. Mm-hmm. Then there were a series of other correspondence where they were asking for additional information in order to close up the file. There was a request that we needed to file with IEMA to close up the large project file in, I think it was the end of August 2015. Okay. And then from there, it was a series of additional correspondence, requests for more information. It was going back and forth between IEMA and FEMA as far as what documentation they were looking for and what other...
And could you explain to us what IEMA is?
It's the emergency, the Illinois Emergency Management Association for Illinois. They're the ones who are granted the EPA or the FEMA funds for allocations to the local agencies. At the time that we were in for our appeal on closing out the project, there were about 700 communities that were under the same circumstances as Lockport Township.
Now you mentioned the key word emergency, correct?
Correct.
What was the emergency?
The emergency was it's a 60-inch corrugated metal pipe under High Road. And it was approximately 20 feet below the inverts, 20 feet below the surface of the road. The culvert length is 100 feet. You got about a 2-to-1 side slope before you get up to the ridge platform, the road platform. The corrugated metal pipe was severely corroded and in jeopardy of collapsing. Okay, so if there was a collapse,
there was a study done on that to prove that?
It was based on the field recommendations from FEMA and from IEMA. They said it was imminent collapse.
And this is all in our documentation?
It's all in the documentation for the grant application, and they're the ones that had recommended it to the township for appealing for these funds.
Okay. All right. Then my second thing to you, then, only because we went on record then, was the fact that over $20,000 or $30,000, whatever it is, needs to go up for bid. John suggested that under your guidance that FEMA was $150,000 and that this was done under a forced account.
Right, there.
Now, it's very clear what FEMA's outlines are on forced accounts. That's reimbursement for the municipal workers for the cleanup. It had nothing to do with the construction itself. Therefore, whether there's grant money or not, that's still over the $30,000, I'll say, needed to go out for bid, and it didn't. That was my problem from the very beginning. Now, whether you guided that or not, I don't know, but that's the thing that led up to when we got a denial. Why did this not go out for bid? And this project was single sourced.
The FEMA recommendations for doing a forced account is considered a major project, but it was under the threshold of $150,000. Mm-hmm. So that's the basis.
But that's FEMA. It doesn't set for our guidelines. Our guidelines still have to be followed under township. Would you agree or disagree?
That I would agree with that, but at the same time, what we were acting on was based on current information and the need for IEMA to get the project completed in that August 2015 timeframe. I mean, when you look back at a project, it's always 2020 hindsight, and there's a lot of things that you're trying to do in a short period of time.
It's pretty clear what it says. We either have an emergency or not. And with that over 100,000, with denial, we're saying, I'm pretty much sure he was saying that it was an emergency, that's what the funds were denied. I don't know that I haven't seen the letter yet that I've requested. So with that being said, over $30,000, it's quite clear that that should have went up for bid, seeing how that comes from, not this township, that goes from state law.
Right, in our discussions with IEMA, they had said go out and solicit proposals. And what we did was we contacted a number of contractors in the area that were capable of doing the work, putting in a 100-foot culvert, 20 feet down, 66-inch diameter. And we only had one bidder other than the original contractor who bid on the
job. Did it go out for bid?
Excuse me?
Did it go out for bid?
No, we requested proposals.
Okay.
And that was the guideline.
Do you have copies of those proposals at all?
There was only one respondent. They did not feel qualified to do the work.
Did you do the proposal through a newspaper? How did you get the proposal out?
No, we did a telephone solicitation for, it's quite very simple project to describe. It's a 66-inch, 100 feet long, 20 feet deep, under a roadway. Are you interested in bidding the project?
So the timeline for this project, you're saying back in 2013 there was a storm that caused some of this corrosion in the culvert, is that correct?
That was with the washout of the gravel around the culvert. The culvert started to deteriorate.
And
we're still holding up. The washout was due to the rain.
I believe the former commissioner, if I remember correctly, worked on that culvert at that time. Is that correct?
Don? Yes.
So the timeline of when the culvert was done, I believe it was in July?
It was done in August of 2015.
When the work was done in July of 2015?
I'm sorry, say that
again. Was it July or August? Was it August of 2015?
We wanted to get it done before the bus routes, and we had to close the road for 2 years.
And then when did you apply for that FEMA grant?
We didn't apply for the FEMA grant, we did.
They approached us. They approached us after the storm and asked what we had as far as...
So back in 2013, the FEMA grant was started?
That's when I was there.
So. That's the earliest entry as far as FEMA documents for acknowledging it and giving a project number.
And that's all in your file there, and is it in the file that you gave me, John,
yes.
The other day you dropped off?
And I guess my last question would be, there was FEMA money granted to, I believe what we say, John, $23,000?
Yeah, for the cleanup.
And that covered specifically cleaning. And I guess maybe because of my ignorance with FEMA, FEMA does cover construction?
Yes.
They do?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Do you want me to move this here?
This is the same copy that I gave you on Thursday.
I will take
it. If you want to keep a file, that's fine.
Thank you for coming, Steve.
Thank you.
Thanks, Steve.
I have nothing else in my commission report.
All right, thank you. Thank you, Jen. I don't have anything else to go tonight in Road and Bridge, unless there's any other questions from the trustees. Hearing none, I would call for an adjournment.
So moved.
Motion by John Bancic.
Second.
Second by Barbara Boyce. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. All right, thank you. We'll be moving on to the General Assistance Fund.
Again, you have the minutes of the monthly meeting of February 6th and the reconvened meeting of 27th, 2017. I do need a motion to pass the minutes.
I'm making a motion to pass the minutes.
I got a motion by John Batisich.
I'll second that.
Seconded by Michael Lewandowski. Any questions? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay, you have the bills of $2,645.64 tonight. I'm going to make a motion to pay the bills.
Make that motion.
I got a motion by Barbara Boyce.
Second.
Seconded by John Batisich. Any questions for the bills for the general assistance tonight?
Ron, I just have one question. I know it was mentioned last meeting, as far as like assistance, where it shows the utilities that are paid.
Right.
I know we also have other items which we provide, such as food and fuel and cars and stuff like that. I mean, I thought maybe we should have that listed on there too. I mean, is that
I did have that put together. I'm sure I apologize. I didn't get it together early enough to put it in your packets. I do have basically, for last month, we did 4 housing, 2 for gas, 5 for electric, 4 for water, 0 for garbage, 1 for fuel, 4 for food. Now, that number comes up higher than the 9 people on general assistance. But what happens is a person will take part of their money in housing, part of it in electric, and maybe part of it in fuel. So that's why 3 are, you know, that's why the number's higher, because they don't take all the money in each individual.
No, I understand. I just thought that, you know, because I know we do purchase food vouchers
and damage.
We should keep track of that somehow. That way we know when. I know that your secretary knows when they need to be replenished, but there's no documentation on the report as far as food.
Right? I will start getting this. If you want to come into the office and talk to Chris and
the executive. I just thought it would be a good idea. We do buy the cards.
Like I said, now on the authority of food, they could all be on the west side of the river, the food bus cards, or they could all be on this side, and that's why we run out, depending on when the cards run out. But yes, they are documented as we get some.
Okay.
But obviously, that information is private information of people's names that are on general assistance, and I can't give that out. Obviously. But I can tell you the number of people getting. Any other questions on the bills? Hearing none, I need a roll call, please.
Lewandowski?
Yes.
Batisich?
Yes.
Alberico?
Yes.
Boyce?
Yes.
Morelli?
Yes.
All right. Any citizens here wishing to ask the general assistance meeting? Anyone wishing to address the board? Hearing none? I have no new business. Under old business, I do have the financial breakdown, the fiscal financial aid for monthly report, where we have 9 on general assistance this month. 8 that requalified, 1 reopened case that was approved. I have no other business in general assistance. I would ask an adjournment.
So
I got a motion by Dan Batisich.
I'll second it.
Seconded by Barbara Boyce. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you very much. We'll be moving on to our senior fund. Again, I have the minutes, and everybody should have received it in their packet. At the monthly meeting of February 6th. In the reconvened meeting of February 27th, 2017. I do need a motion to pass the minutes.
I'll make the motion.
I got a motion by Barbara Boyce.
I'll second that.
And a second by Michael Lewandowski. Any questions about the minutes? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you very much. You have the bills of $7,568.98. If you need a motion to pay the bill.
So moved.
I'm sorry, who is that?
I'm in.
John Batisich, I got a motion by?
I'll second it.
Second by Barbara Boyce. Any questions for the bills? Hearing none, I need a roll call, please.
Lewandowski?
Yes.
Bodison?
Yes.
Barbarico?
Yes.
Boyce?
Yes.
Morelli?
Yes.
All right, thank you. Any citizens wishing to address the board for senior fund? Hearing none. I have no new business or old business. I will call for an adjournment.
So moved.
I got a motion by Jen Bodasich.
Second.
Seconded by Barbara Boyce. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? All right. We'll be moving on to our town fund agenda. Again, you have the minutes in your packet of the monthly meeting of February 6th and the reconvened meeting of 2017. You also have in your packet the workshop meeting of February 22nd. I do need a motion to pass the minutes.
Make a motion.
I got a motion by Barb Boyce, seconded by Michael Lewandowski. Any questions in the minutes? Hearing none, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. You have bills of $105,943.70. I do need a motion.
I'll make that motion.
I got a motion by John Bodasich.
I'll second it.
Seconded by Barbara Boyce. Any questions on the bills? Hearing none, can I have a roll call, please?
Lewandowski?
Yes.
Bodasich?
Yes.
Barbarico?
Yes.
Boyce?
Yes.
Morelli?
Yes.
All right. Any citizens wishing to address the board here tonight for the town fund? Hearing none, well, the assessor's not here tonight. She's out of town. I'm going to go to the clerk's report.
Thank you, Ron. So the annual town meeting is drawing near. It'll be Tuesday, April 11, 2017, right here in this building at 6:30. Any requests for agenda items needed to be in the clerk's office by March 1st. We did receive a request on 2/24/17. And the request reads as follows. Lockport Township Clerk from Ron Alvarico, Lockport Township Supervisor, annual town meeting request. This is a request for approval to rent space in township building. Lockport Township Board of Trustees is requesting permission of the electors at the annual town meeting to be held on April 11, 2017 at 1463 South Farrell Road, Lockport, Illinois, Township Building to lease available space within the Township Building to entities, organizations, groups, or individuals other than the Supervisor's Office, Township Clerk's Office, and the Township Assessor's Office. If approved, a standard lease will be drafted for use with each leasee of available space. This request is for the annual town meeting to be held on April 11, 2017. Thank you in advance. Sincerely, Ron Alvarico, Lockport Township Supervisor. So before you, Board of Trustees, you do have an annual town meeting agenda. If you did everybody receive it, this has to be approved tonight. So that we can publish and post this 15 days before the meeting. The agenda is as follows. The call meeting to order, the Pledge of Allegiance, public notice, which will be read, nominations from the floor for moderator, election of moderator, motion to appoint moderator, oath of office with moderator, public comment, approval of minutes from the previous annual town meeting, motion to dispense with the reading of the full financial report, motion to accept the financial report. Resolution to approve rent space in the township building. The voting method that will be used. A motion to set the time and date for the next annual town meeting. Any other miscellaneous matters as authorized by law and adjournment.
I'll make that motion to proceed with using this as a for the agenda for the town meeting Tuesday, April 11, 2017.
Got a motion? Second. Second by Barbara Boyce. Any questions? Board? Hearing none, I ask for a roll call.
Lewandowski?
Yes.
Bodasich?
Yes.
Alvarico?
Yes.
Boyce?
Yes.
Morelli?
Yes.
I would like to add, Supervisor Alvarico, that The minutes for the annual town meeting are online in draft form. The financial report will be online as soon as it is complete, and the agenda will also be online for anyone that needs to look at that. No, I have a few other things if you don't mind. Thank you. So the clerk's office was out at Romeoville High School and Lockport High School registering voters. We also did I did a Saturday, February 25th at Shiloh Baptist Church. Registration is complete now for the April 4th election. You can register to vote at the county clerk's office. It's called grace period voting that is going on now until election day. So you go into the county, you register to vote, and you vote at the same time. That will also be in effect at the polls on election day, April 4th. You go to the polls, you register to vote at the polls, make sure you have the proper identification with you, and then you can vote at your polls on election day. So that, like I said, that is over as far as registering now, but you can do it at the county clerk's office. I also was out at Senior Star registering voters and doing some absentee ballots. I would like to also add that the state of Illinois will be coming tomorrow to the clerk's office, and we're going to be meeting with the supervisor's office to get our application all up to date. So that is going to happen tomorrow for our records of retention. On May 4th will be our next baby youth clinic, so that's coming up too. And then early voting. So that is going to take place a week from today, which is March 20th, in the clerk's office. Our hours will be 9 to 4, Monday through Friday. We will have two Saturday hours from 9 to noon, which will be March 25th and April 1st. So please exercise your right to vote. You can do early voting, vote by mail, or go to the polls. So. Options are out there for everybody. And I think that's all. Andrew?
Thank you very much. All right, any trustees with comments or suggestions?
Denise, you're going through the methods of voting. I mean, people can also have a ballot mailed to the residents.
Yes, it's called vote by mail or absentee vote. Yes.
Okay,
it's very popular.
Do they call you or do they have to call?
They can call our office. We need to process them through the county clerks, or they can call the county clerk directly, or they can go online and apply for an absentee vote by mail ballot.
All right. Nothing else. We'll move on to the Central Square report. We're not there no more, but I did want to just, I did receive an email from Ben Benson, who took over Central Square building. They did close out the accounts finally. We did receive a check for $32,888.07 for the remainder. That's the spending of what was ever left of the accounts. So now we are totally done with Central Square. All bills have been paid and it's done. So, and we did receive some of our money back from this year. That's all I have to say about Central Square. Other than there's a nice building and we miss it. Going on to new business, tonight we have Barb Morrissette here, along with Nikki Zernicki.
Yep.
Zernicki? Okay, I'd like to have them come up. She said that Barb would like to speak and introduce us.
Before I introduce Nikki, I'd like to say thank you to the board, Judy Bodicich, who started our senior program, Ryan Perico, who has continued it, and all of you who have been most supportive of us throughout the years. Some of you serve on our committees and in our groups, and we really appreciate that. As you know, we have 5 senior groups who benefit from this assistance: Golden Age, Senior Vets, our Silver and Gold, and Young Timers, and the Fairmont Food Pantry. So thank you so much. It's been a pleasure working with all of you. I'll miss you. Come out to Manhattan and see what you can do up there. There's nothing going on out there. So Anyway, right now, I'd like to introduce Nikki Sarecki. She is my replacement. She's got lots of energy, lots of ideas, and she'd be glad to work with you. So thank you so much, and here's Nikki.
Hi, my name is Nikki Zarnicki. I just started with the Lockport Township Park District. I started it in September in the marketing department. Now I got transferred over to the trailer in the recreation department. I'm very excited for this position, and I'm excited to work with the township. I've worked with Ronald Rico for at least a month now. I've seen him at different meetings, and it's been really nice meeting Denise as well, and I'm just looking forward to working with the township. So I am at a different extension. If you're going to reach Barb at her normal extension, I am at 323 instead of 206. But if you do decide to call her, it'll just shoot you a message saying, I'm no longer here. Call me at 323. So any questions or anything, you can find my contact information online. Thank you so much.
Nikki, I'm really looking forward to working with you, and I hope we're going to continue having a close relationship, as close to one as I have with Barb from the years. I'm looking forward to it. Next on the agenda is a resolution number 2017-1. I'd like to pass this resolution honoring our Morrissette for her retirement. I need a motion.
I'll make the motion.
I got a motion by Jerry Bodicic.
A second.
Second by Barbara Boyce. Can I have a roll call, please?
Morelli?
Yes.
Boyce?
Yes.
Alberico?
Yes.
Yes.
Lewandowski?
Yes.
All right, motion carries. That being said, I would like to ask Barbara, please come back up to the podium real quick. I'd like to read the resolution. And I'm not a real good reader, so bear with me. This is Resolution 2017, Resolution honoring Barbara Morrissette for her dedicated service to Lockport Township community. Whereas Barbara Morrissette has distinguishedly for 41 years of service to the Lockport Township Park District, whose tireless and dedicated service has earned her the gratitude of the entire community. And whereas Barbara Morrissette started at Lockport Township Park District in the position of secretary, and whereas Barbara Morrissette served the Lockport Township Park District as Park District Senior Program Administrator and Museums Supervisor, and whereas Barbara Morrissette also arranged trips and travel for residents of Lockport Township, and whereas Barbara Morrissette implemented senior clubs, Silver and Gold Club, Golden Ages Club, Young Timers Club, and an active member of AARP, and whereas Barbara Morrissette is a member of the Lockport Women's Club for 46 years and three-time past president, and whereas Barbara Morrissette started the food pantry at the Fairmont Community Center, and whereas Barbara Morrissette is retiring from the Lockport Park District on February 2017, after faithfully and respectively serving the residents of Lockport Township for 41 years, and for her dedication to her job and loyalty to her employees and peers, and now therefore be it resolved by the Lockport Township elected officials as follows. Section 1, Lockport Township Board offers their congratulations and profound expression of thanks to Barbara Morrissette for her long tenure of 41 years of dedicated service to the Lockport Township Park District and the residents of Lockport Township. Section 2, Lockport Township Board extends their best wishes to Barbara Morrissette for a productive and joyful future and for her continued success in whatever endeavor she chooses. Section 3, Lockport Township Clerk is to make this the original of this resolution available to the members of the general public during business hours. Resolved and passed this 13th day of March 2017. Thank you, Barb. I want you to have this. resolution. I really appreciate all the things you've done, and for a token of our appreciation of all that you've done for this township, and my mentor, who helped me, and we want to present you with this clock. I know you don't need a clock, you're retired now.
I said when I retired, I told my husband, no clock and no calendar. However, this can be our clock. So thank you very much. It's been most rewarding. I do have one correction, though. I did not start the Fairmont Food Pantry. Sis Carter did, and I worked with her and Rose Walton for many years, and they certainly were role models. And that's what you need in this job, is role models. So, you're all my role models. Thank you.
Thank you.
Barb, I apologize for that and some of that information, but I personally want to thank you for being my mentor and my role model. And I want to thank you for implementing the idea of our baby youth clinic. I know that that many years ago, the Lockport Women's Club had this clinic here in Lockport, and it went over fantastic. This clinic has been going on for a year now. It's starting to pick up, and I thank you for bringing that idea forward and allowing me to work on that for our township residents. I'm going to miss your wisdom, your guidance, and your experience. So you are a great asset.
So. I'm only a phone call.
Thank you.
And I don't mean to try to upwind you.
Yeah, that's okay.
I do have to thank Barb for, Barb and I once had the discussion with me that she's pretty much the one that helped me come up with the shingle shots program. And I think the one program, I thank Barb for the being a mentor to me and giving us that idea. It turned out to be pretty good.
And John, don't forget that path going up to
We'll take care of that.
All right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next on the agenda, I need approval for the Will County Community, a donation for approval for the Will County Community Concerns Gala. It's their 30th anniversary in Will County. I sent a letter to the board here. Basically, what I'm asking is for a donation of it's up to the board, but I'm going to suggest around $300 for a gala for a silent auction basket or something to that effect. Will County Community Concerns helps a lot of our residents in Lockport Township through the years. They have an outreach program that does meet here the third Thursday, I believe, of every month from LIHEAP. And I can't say enough about the program.
So I'll make that motion.
I got a motion by John Badasich.
300.
300. I got a motion by John Badasich.
Second
by Dr. Boyce. Any questions? Hearing none, can I have a roll call, please?
Yes.
Badasich.
Yes.
Yes.
Boyce.
Yes.
Morelli.
Yes.
All right, thank you very much. The only other thing I have in new business, really quick, I wanted to touch on the weather. We are starting to get into the tornado season. I want the people in the television that do see this to be prepared. This is a tornado month, I believe, is what they call it. It's just a good time to start thinking about preparedness for any kind of bad weather, whether it's snow, lizards, or tornadoes at this time. We've had some pretty rough weather already this month. Going on to old business, I just wanted to bring up really quick. I handed out the scholarships last month. They were supposed to be turned in today. Anybody that doesn't have them quite done, please get them to my office by Wednesday, Thursday this week. I really appreciate it. I don't want to have to make that decision myself. I think it should be a group effort of deciding who gets our scholarships. Everybody in our township should have received their new newsletter for the spring newsletter. I think it came out pretty good. There's a lot of good information in that thing. Make sure you just read it. lot of good numbers, what we do, programming, please go through it. And if you didn't receive it, our office will get you one out there. I don't have anything else in old business, meetings and correspondence. Just one thing I did want to, everybody in there should have received in their package, just a little thank you note that we received. We receive these quite often from our residents. I think it's just important that this, thanks one of our dispatchers on the bus. Just a thank you note helping for my friend with the, oh, thank you for it, it's not for the bus, it's for the transfer chair from our medical closet. We do have a medical closet that we lend the equipment out to. Anybody in our township that needs any kind of medical, a walker, transfer chair, a wheelchair, things like that, can use it for as long as you need it. All we do is ask you to return it when you're done. And this is just a thank you note, thanking her for the kindness of helping her load it and bring it to her car. And she just says, God bless us. And I just want to we do get thank you notes from our residents. I really do appreciate that. Other than that, I have nothing else unless the board has anything else tonight. The only other thing I would say is St. Patrick's Day is coming up at the end of the week. Everybody have a good, happy St. Patrick's Day and say enjoy your corned beef and cabbage. I believe the Pope gave us dispensation to the Catholics. Enjoy it. I have nothing else. I would ask for an adjournment.
So moved.
Motion by Jen Babcic.
I'll second it.
Second by Michael Lewandowski. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it. Thank you very much, everybody.